Okay, even the song is making me laugh. All right, so it's time. It's time to do this. We do this occasionally. We're getting together the nose to talk about a movie. I think I sort of have to do a little preamble here. I'll do it really quickly. But so back in maybe 1997, when my son was maybe almost eight, or maybe he was eight, you know, when you'd go to Blockbuster on a winter afternoon and you just walk around and you'd seen every single damn movie there, or the movies you hadn't seen you didn't want to see, or they were inappropriate or whatever. And so in that state of mind, we saw a movie on a shelf in the Bishop's Corner West Hartford Blockbuster called Bottle Rocket. And we looked at it, and there was nobody we'd ever heard of in it except for James Caan. James Caan was in it. And so we took it home, and it was made, it looked like it was made for about $60,000. But it was really kind of brilliant. And it had these guys, Luke Wilson and Owen Wilson, who nobody had ever seen before. There's even another Wilson brother who's also in it. And we just fell in love with it. I think we might have watched it twice before bringing it back. And a love story was born, and he and I saw a lot of those movies. He's kind of dropped out of the Wes Anderson race a little bit lately. So I'm not neutral on the subject of Wes Anderson. I'm more of a completist. However, the entire time that was happening, there was a dark presence watching us, the Eye of Mordor. And that would be one of our panelists today, America's greatest living film critic and my very good friend David Edelstein, who has no truck with most of this Wes Anderson stuff. Also joining us today, Sam Hadleman, works in music public relations and hosts The Sam Hadleman Show on Radio Free Brooklyn. And Carolyn Payne is an actress, comedian, dancer, founder, director of and choreographer of Kinetic Dance, oceanographer, submersible pilot. She does a little of everything. And in fact, in the second segment of today's show, we're going to talk about the way the tragedy of the Titan, the submersible Titan run by a company called OceanGate, or maybe a former company called OceanGate, kind of turned into social media fodder and became this thing that we, you know, one of these social media Rorschach blots onto which we project all kinds of barely appropriate attitudes. But first, indeed, Asteroid City. And before we hear from the panel, let's hear from the cast of thousands. So this clip features Hope Davis, Liev Schreiber, Tom Hanks, Tony Revolori, who was the lobby boy in Grand Budapest, but who's counting, and Jeffrey Wright, among other famous actors, A1 Cat.
Oh.
How long can they keep us in Asteroid City? Legally, I mean.
Well, I'm not an attorney, but I'd say as long as they like. I think we'd have to file an injunction and successfully argue the case 6 months to a year. Of course, we'd also need to initiate a civil suit for loss of income.
Maybe we should just walk out right now. I'm not sure they could stop us without killing somebody.
Interesting idea. What kind of mileage do you think that jetpack gets?
Ask Roger or his son. Apparently, he's being prosecuted for revealing state secrets.
I'll never make it stick.
I'm in no hurry. I like the desert. I like aliens.
Paul!
How'd you get that back? The projects remain under secure lockdown. No stargazers permitted personal access without the express
permission. My son invented this death ray.
That may be true, but my
Step
orders
back.
Are...
Easy, fellas. We're not in Guadalcanal anymore.
Okay, everyone, please. It's been a typical quarantine.
I'll stop you right now!
Stand down! You hear that? General Gibson says stand down.
You married?
Of course.
All right. So there's a lot going on there. It's a hard movie to summarize, but it's roughly 1955. We're in a very sort of rose and turquoise colored desert town, very 1955 and kind of Bakelite looking, and some kind of awards ceremony or something, a convention of, well, here, let me just get it right here. It's Junior Stargazer Space Cadet Convention is happening, and some awards are going to be given out, except that there's a kind of an alien intervention here, and they have to be quarantined. I think that's what you're hearing. The movie stars Jason Schwartzman, Scarlett Johansson, Tom Hanks, Jeffrey Wright, Tilda Swinton, Bryan Cranston, Edward Norton, Adrien Brody, Liev Schreiber, Hope Davis, Stephen Park, Rupert Friend, and I'm really just getting started. I mean, Steve Carell and Margot Robbie have really pretty small cameos, as does Matt Dillon. I could go on. Seu George, the Brazilian musician who played David Bowie songs in Portuguese all the way through Life Aquatic, is like in this little band. Barely noticed. It's stuff like that. So I don't think we can begin with the skunk at the garden party. I think we have to build to the skunk at the garden party. So, Carolyn, maybe just get us started. What was your relationship to Asteroid City?
You know, I'm a Wes Anderson fan. I'm not like a super fan, but I do really enjoy Wes Anderson. This is a very Wes Anderson movie. It's sort of like peak Wes Anderson. So it has all the things that we know and love about him, like his stylized, the colors, the way it's shot, this, you know, cavalcade of stars doing small cameos almost. And this kind of sense of choose your own adventure is how you interpret it, you know, and the acting styles where these actors are just deadpanning through it. So if you are a Wes Anderson fan, this is going to be something you're going to love. It wasn't my favorite Wes Anderson, but I definitely, other than I'm embarrassed to admit, I did come home and Google because I got into a panic as I was leaving the theater that I did not understand this movie. but this movie definitely is designed for you to, I think, kind of go home and process and choose how you are emotionally relating to it. And even the actors admitted that, you know, they all had different interpretations. So that made me feel better about it. Because there was a moment where I was leaving Real Art Ways last night and I was like, wow, is it possible that I did not understand what I just saw? Am I not as smart as I think I am? So as long as you go into it liking Wes Anderson and being willing to feel like maybe you didn't understand something, it's great.
It is a lot of fun, whether you understand it or not, or it's not. You're about to hear exactly why it might not be any fun. I do want to say, first of all, we're catching the movie kind of in transit from the big screen, from movie theaters into streaming release. It's about a week away, I think, from streaming release. So you might be able to find it on a movie screen this weekend. You might have to wait a week. I don't know. It's unclear to me where you're going to see this if you haven't already. So let's bring out the Eye of Mordor now. So David Edelstein, go ahead. You have the floor. Say what it is you need to say.
I'm seething here, being referred to as a skunk, as the Eye of Mordor. I want to say that, you know, Wes Anderson's two fully animated movies, The Fantastic Mr. Fox and Isle of Dogs, are two of my favorite animated movies of the last 25 years. I liked the Darjeeling Limited. I remain open to Wes Anderson's twee tomfoolery, despite all evidence to the contrary. I would have to agree with Carolyn. A lot of this movie, by the way, you know, I was a professional film critic for a very long time. And if I didn't understand a movie, I went back and I thought about it and I thought about it. And if I still didn't understand it, I could fake it with the best of them. I'm really flummoxed by a lot of what was in this movie. The dialogue was sort of pitched like a dog whistle, went over my head. The frames within frames, the recursiveness, the play within a play. It reminded me of the movie within a movie. It reminded me a little bit of Thornton Wilder's The Skin of Our Teeth, and even a little bit of Our Town. But I saw all of his themes, you know, all of his usual themes in there. Here it's people waiting around. There's a nuclear holocaust in the background, a police state, an alien visitation. If you are on its wavelength, and perhaps someday in the future, post brain surgery or a brain injury, I might well be on its wavelength. But let me take a minute, Colin, because you as viewers, as listeners might or might not know, we do communicate before these wondrous colloquies, and you do have a theory of Wes Anderson involving depression that I think you should share with us, because I think it's fascinating. I have a lot of questions about it, and I think it would get us right to the heart of young Wes very quickly, if you would.
Yeah, well, my theory basically is in the sense that when we watch slapstick, physical slapstick, we watch Buster Keaton, The Three Stooges, The Pink Panther, whatever, we're seeing what would be in real life very, very painful injuries that you would not want to endure. They would send you to the ER. But we're laughing at them because they exist in a safe space for us, so we can laugh. And some of our laughter, I think, is sort of nervous laughter about, wow, if I ever got hit in the head that hard, it would be a real problem. And I think Wes does that with emotional pain, especially depression. You know, almost all of his movies are about depression, including Fantastic Mr. Fox, and about what you do about depression. But they exist usually within this sort of incredibly visually colorful space and twee playfulness. So it's kind of a way for us to look at depressed people and maybe our own depression and look at it in a safer way as just sort of part of, this is part of life, you know? I mean, life can be very beautiful and fun.
That's so brilliant. That's so brilliant. And I want to try to unpack it. Okay. I've been thinking and thinking about this since you wrote this. Okay, you have human beings. You have famous actors that are dressed, posed like mannequins and speaking very quickly and with highly theatrical diction in these endlessly parodied, off-symmetrical, color-coordinated dollhouse frames. Now, I am not so literal-minded as to ask, what does it mean? Because it doesn't have to mean anything. It's a work of art. But what is the relationship of these artificial characters to this artificial space? Are we meant to see, I don't know, the sad human face, helpless and alone, depressed in this over-controlled, almost straitjacketed existence? Or are we watching a megalomaniacal auteur director who likes to make dollhouses with A-list human dolls? I don't know.
Well, let's go to Sam Hadleman and see if he can set us straight here. Sam, I'm sure you've got to take that. We'll put all of these questions to rest.
Yeah, no, I think that's always been my thing with Wes Anderson. Like, I watched The Royal Tenenbaums like way, way too early in life. I think it might have been the first movie I ever purchased on Amazon. And when Colin started talking about like depression and how it kind of embodies that, I kind of thought of Rushmore and the relationship between Jason Schwartzman and Bill Murray and how it's kind of like a depiction of like how aimlessly and alone age makes things feel. Like, if that makes sense, like, Bill Murray's obviously going through like this weird midlife crisis where he's doing like cannonballs and pools, smoking cigarettes with two beers. And this really like lost and confused student is trying to find his way around like a really preppy school that he doesn't like fit in. Like, I don't really think, and I think that's a problem with these last couple Wes Anderson films, is that they don't need to be such a hipster potluck. Like, he doesn't need to like bring in this awesome big IMDb cast. Like, my, and Colin brought this up in the email, my favorite Wes Anderson is like the really simple, bare bones stuff. Like, I think that was the problem with this film, at least for me. Like, aesthetically beautiful. I really love how it depicted loneliness and isolation. And I wonder if like the pandemic played a role in him talking about like quarantining and kind of having to stay.
It's absolutely clear. They do quarantine, yeah. And it's got to be shot right around that time. And we now know that Bill Murray is supposed to be in the movie and he got COVID in Ireland 4 days before shooting began and couldn't really be used. And Carolyn, to that point, one thing that I'll say about this that I'd love to get your reaction is, I mean, usually I have to see a Wes Anderson movie two or three or four times before I really kind of feel like I've absorbed some of the valences. But also, because there's so much packed into it, I mean, with this one, I really feel I'll probably watch it at least another two times and maybe more than that, just to even pick up some of these little tiny performances of pretty interesting actors or little jokes within jokes within jokes. And we should say that this is, what did McNichol say? It's a play with a TV show within a play within a movie or something, very similar to Grand Budapest Hotel, which also had that kind of Russian doll nesting quality. But Carolyn, I actually do have a question, which is, isn't it kind of fun to see a movie where there's kind of more than you can absorb? I walk out of a lot of movies and think, well, yeah, I certainly understood that movie because there wasn't that much to have to understand.
I mean, I guess, yeah, it's nice to feel like you know, your money was well spent and you have a lot to chew on, but it also, it stressed me out, like, oh my God, what didn't I understand? Did I get up and go to the bathroom and miss everything important? Like, did I zone out? Am I not capable of wrapping my head around this like multi-layered metaverse he's created here? So there is that element, and maybe I'm the only person who has that sort of instinctive stress that happens where my brain explodes. I think that a movie like this, it is kind of nice to have something where it is fun to watch. Like, unlike some movies that are really trying to provoke you into and feeling that they take away away kind of that sense of fun. This has that. You definitely laugh out loud at a lot of this. It is not a movie where you're going to be mad as you're watching it. It's sort of more at the end, you just have to take that time with it. And I agree. I think upon second viewing and even third viewing, I think like Wes Anderson is, and this movie specifically, he creates these worlds and these characters and these little nuanced jokes that you have to go back and really want to look for and dig through and figure out. And I think that that's kind of fun.
I mean, it may be that, you know, 5, 6, 7, 100 viewings into the future, we will all agree this is a masterpiece, but I have a hard time making that leap of faith. I'm not saying it's the Emperor's New Clothes and the Emperor doesn't have any clothes. The Emperor obviously has very, very pretty clothes. I'm just not sure he's wearing any underwear.
Well, you know, one question that I have for you, just because you know the business better than the rest of us, is, you know, because I wonder about this too. Why do you think so many people want to be in these movies? I mean, people who could, you know, and a lot of times it's very little screen time. I mean, these are, as you said, A-list actors who sometimes have, like, I don't know, Fisher Stevens from Succession is in this movie. You could have fooled me. Why do all these, you know, the Cranstons and the Tom Hanks and Rita Wilson, isn't it too? Why do you think they want to do this stuff?
I don't know, man. I mean, he doesn't pay. He pays scale.
Yeah.
They just, it's kind of it's a hipster collective. They want to say, I'm in a West. All of these people are incredible egomaniacs, and they can actually tell themselves that they're being kind of humble in being sort of subservient to this director's vision. They're like, oh, okay, I'm putting myself in your hands. And that's why, you know, my favorite performances in Wes Anderson's movies kind of usually, you know, are by people who haven't gotten along with Wes Anderson, like Gene Hackman during the Royal Tenenbaums. You know, Wes tried to pose the guy and give him line readings, and he nearly ripped Wes's head off. I will say Scarlett Johansson, I think, pulls a multi-layered character out of herself, and she is wonderful in this movie. She's a great actress, and she's wonderful in this movie. Jeffrey Wright has some amusing intonations. Maya Hawke was fun to watch, to see sort of signs of her mom in there and her mom's kind of good humor. The alien was funny. But I was really, I was so deadly bored by the other actors in this movie. And I was so bored by that horizontal moving camera. You know, it seems like every time he would cut to a new frame, the camera would move across the screen again in what just seemed like a sort of monotonic, boring, you know, sort of entrancingly boring style. So I didn't feel the passion in this film. I didn't feel the emotion in this film. To me, it did not transcend the externals, which, yeah, were pretty impressive. I was, you know, you guys sound like you were entertained by it. I was really bored and exasperated and exfoliated and exsanguined by any X things by it. So sorry.
It's okay. No apology necessary. Yeah, Sam, one of the Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead. Yeah. Carolyn, go ahead.
Yep. Oh, I was just going to say that my biggest frustration with this movie was Jeff Goldblum, who, if any actor could ever, I think, sparkle in Wes Anderson style acting and film, it would be Jeff Goldblum with his very unique delivery. And we got just one line from him, and I don't know if he did the body acting in a suit. I didn't Google that, if he did the body act actual alien or just did that one line. But that was one of my biggest frustrations. I thought when the credits rolled at the beginning and I saw Jeff Goldblum was playing the alien, that felt to me like there was a lot of promise of something there.
You wanted more actors in this movie.
Right. I did. Exactly. So I have the opposite gripe.
You can just watch this weekend. You can watch The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou, in which Jeff Goldblum has a pretty big role. And, you know, Sam, one of the things that really struck me here is that, you know, for all of these A-list and A-minus list actors who were in there, really, like, a lot of the screen time goes to this guy, Jake Ryan, who plays Woodrow Steenbeck, who's the son of Jason Schwartzman's character, and Grace Edwards, who plays the daughter of Scarlett Johansson's character. And this guy, Jake Ryan, I mean, I think he really sort of is another, you know, perfect Wes Anderson actor. He has that kind of blankness to him, you know, and this kind of stillness to him. And he's not a particularly attractive young man. And there's a way in which, you know, for all the fancy people who show up, it is often these people you've never heard of, similar to Tony Revolori as the lobby boy in Grand Budapest. You know, you
before
sort of
you
think,
answer, can I just ask, before you answer, is there, were those fake matching moles on the two juveniles?
Am I expected to know that?
I'd expect you to know that.
All right.
Well, moles turn, actors with moles turn up in a lot, or birthmarks turn up in a lot of his movies. Huh. I don't know. Maybe that's a question for specialists.
Right. No, there actually is a documentary called Dermatology in Wes Anderson Movies, and I would commend it to you. I think Netflix has it right now. But yeah, Sam, you could now answer any question you want to answer, not the one I asked.
And I think this kind of like ties back to the conversation we had of like why actors want to be in these movies, is because Wes Anderson's kind of found himself in this unique space where like he can pack a theater with like a hipster fodder movie. Like I tried to see the movie in Brooklyn opening weekend, and I tried to get the ticket at the desk, and the guy laughed at me. He was like, "You're not getting in here. That's crazy." Usually when I see Wes Anderson movies, it's me and like seven old ladies in New Haven. But this time I tried to watch it in Brooklyn. But yeah, I think that's especially with that kid that you were talking about, Jake Ryan, like, I think that's kind of what's been missing in his movies, is that, like, I don't really get why he's leaned so hard into bringing everybody and their mother into these movies when it could be a really interesting platform to introduce, like, newer, more awkward kind of, you know, what's that word people like? Avant-garde performances. I'd really like the fun of that to return back to his movies. Like, I don't really need to see Timothée Chalamet in a Wes Anderson movie. That sounds like a TikTok Mad Lib. Like, well, I'm really good.
Yeah. Speaking of TikTok, we just got a couple of minutes left. And Carolyn, you should say a little bit about some of the sort of ancillary Wes Anderson experiences available to us on the wonderful thing known as the internet.
Yeah. I mean, if you are a Wes Anderson fan, or even if you're not, and you just like to pose as a hipster, cool film person on social media, there is a big trend right now where you film yourself as if you are in a Wes Anderson movie. It uses like a song from one of his soundtracks. And there's even an AI app that you can download that helps if you can't find the perfect accidentally Wes Anderson backdrop, which is another amazing thing you can follow on Instagram. If you can't find the perfect backdrop to Wes Anderson out, you can even use an AI app that will turn a building into pastel pink around you so that you can really nail the aesthetic and be your own be your own star of a Wes Anderson film and be as pretentious as all the celebrities clamoring to be in it.
I really
see how easy it is to parody him. See how, I mean, the fact that he repeats himself. People say, "Oh, you can tell by one frame it's a Wes Anderson movie." Yeah, no kidding. You can tell by one frame. I mean, is that a good thing? I mean, some people would say it is. I don't know. When I first reviewed him, I wrote something that probably in retrospect seems incredibly dumb. I quoted John Gielgud, who was quoting somebody else, I can't remember who, saying, "Once you learn to do something well, you have to control it and do it more selectively." Well, Wes goes to the opposite extreme. He does it, you know, to the nth degree, and then the nth beyond the nth degree. And, you know, at a certain point, it seems like self-parody.
Right. I do want to say, I want to recommend, if you have any sense of the Wes Anderson sensibility anyway, if not, don't bother, because this would mean nothing to you. But of those TikTok videos that Carolyn is talking about, the first one I ever done was done on Shoreline East here in Connecticut. It got 12 million views, which actually, you know, a baked potato can get 12 million views on TikTok. But I mean, it's really funny. I mean, she just did a tremendous job. She's, an artist or photographer from Brooklyn, just taking a train home from visiting her parents.
Yeah,
and she just killed it.
I saw that. I was like, you guys are romanticizing taking the MTA. My culture is not your costume. Like, I was like, this is great that people are taking these hipster aesthetics. Like, You guys didn't grow up in Connecticut. You don't know.
All right. We have to go. We have to take a break. We're going to come back, and we're going to go just the way Steve Zissou did under the ocean in a submersible.
Holy dee. There alien who art in heaven. Holy dee. Lean and skinny, holy about dee. 6'7".
Holy dee.
Don't we know holy you dee. Ain't our brother, holy or you friend or foe.
Or other.
Hop on 1 foot, skip on 2, dance face with hat lady. Bounce on 4, swing on 3, left face face with hat lady.
We are back. Our panel today on The Nose is David Edelstein, Sam Hadleman, and Carolyn Payne. Their qualifications are too numerous for me to list here because we've got to go undersea. So during the last, well, starting sort of in the third week of June, I think we became aware of the fact that a submersible called Titan, which was diving down near the wreckage of the Titanic, owned by a company called OceanGate, and was a form of kind of undersea, deep undersea tourism, something you could pay a large amount of money to go do, was off the sonar, so to speak. Nobody really could find it. And I don't need to tell you all this. It was all the eyes and ears of the world were upon this for a really long time. But I think many of us did notice that there was a fascination with this that kind of went beyond the just the numbers and letters of the tragedy. There was a way in which we've begun to process things on the interwebs and especially through social media where they become a Rorschach blot, right? We project whatever it is that we're interested in onto it and make it into that thing. And so Carolyn Payne, I'm going to have you get us started because you're the one who brought this up as a very interesting topic idea. And you, in fact, did go down. I guess you can't have rabbit holes on the bottom of the ocean, but whatever you do have down there, you went down them.
Yeah, I definitely was in deep on this. I first heard about it. I heard this. I was scrolling and I saw something OceanGate, something involving the Titanic. And I assumed that OceanGate, I had never heard of the company OceanGate. And I assumed, you know, how we have like Watergate and everything since. Every time something is some sort of disaster or scandal, we call it a gate. So at first I thought it was just something, you know, it drew me right in with that. And then I realized the multifaceted layers of wild connections and loops. I mean, it was great. I felt like Charlie Day with his like bulletin board of like lines connecting things. You know, the fact that this was a submersible going to visit the Titanic and the guy who, you know, stopped in Rush, who started this company, his wife, her grandparents were the ones who fell asleep holding each other on the Titanic as it sunk. And it was just like every little detail that that I uncovered and that I was reading and seeing just was fascinating. And then plus the like psychological impact of thinking about being inside a submersible like this and just floating there in darkness with death impending was so much more haunting than any horror movie that I have seen or series that I've watched. It just was so intriguing. This was like a real gift the past month of something to follow. It just the internet just really delivered on this, from the memes to the reactions to just, you know, getting to live react to something collectively. I don't know. I just think that this was a real cultural phenomena. And I know that we have had so many things where we're getting to like live react to and that we all kind of fall into these like rabbit holes of obsession with. But this one I felt was really, really unique. I noticed like everyone that you mentioned it to would just get excited and say, oh yeah, I'm following that too. And how, you know, or I knew it blew up the whole time. Well, it imploded, but yeah, it just is. It really was fascinating. And I can't wait to see what comes from this cinematically and just where it goes for us with all these crazy tourism, like space tourism and underwater tourism. I feel lucky that I am not rich enough to even be tempted to want to do any of these things. So, yeah, I think that's where I'm at with all of this.
So Sam, what about you? In what way, if any, did you geek out on this?
Well, usually I try to avoid the news at all costs because both my parents just play the news all day in the house. So I just kind of tuned it out. But I was pulled in by this. I think I think what my theory is that this is the first time in a while where a story, not to be so, you know, grim, but a story made national news that wasn't like a school shooting or about a pandemic or about some big political sphere. Like, this was like a movie being made in front of us. It was funny. It kind of reminded me of Crimson Tide. If any of you guys remember that movie, Gene Hackman, Denzel movie, but like way less fun. I just couldn't get over the fact that like a group of people died over the Titanic in a similar way as the Titanic did. Like, the people on the Titanic were not the last people to die near the Titanic in the water. I think I emailed this. It'd be like going to Pompeo and getting stuck in a volcanic eruption. Like, that is just such a one. And it's like, I think what drew people was like the story of the negligence from the boss, how the expectations were so high and people kept warning him about it. I read this fantastic piece in The Atlantic about it. There's just something to peel back for everybody. You could, if you hate billionaires, if you're afraid of the ocean, if you're fascinated by the Titanic, if you want to hear James Cameron talk for 4 minutes, which God, I really don't want to, whatever you're into, there's something for everybody in the story.
Yeah. I mean, I think I want to go to Mr. Edelstein here, but there's two things that I was kind of fascinated by. The sense, I mean, you know, Sam just mentioned Cameron. Well, he seems like a ridiculous person to talk to, except he knows a tremendous amount about submersibles and going down by the Titanic. He really is one of the world's leading experts on this exact place and going down there in that kind of thing, which I think also made it kind of blur between reality and fiction. And David, I also feel like, you know, I did sense a lot of sort of eat the rich, you know, reactions to this. It was White Lotus and The Menu and stuff like that. It was sort of, these are rich people who can afford a certain kind of fun. They died. Too bad for them, but maybe not as bad as for other people.
Yeah, I mean, that made me very uncomfortable. First of all, I think there was a great piece. I didn't see The Atlantic, but there's a great piece in The New Yorker that really spoke to a number of people who had left the company under very unfortunate circumstances. But yeah, I mean, while this was going on, before we knew, a lot of people seemed to know that there was no hope from the beginning that it had imploded. But while we were all sitting there day after day, you know, some of us were thinking about people in a submersible with their oxygen running out and what it would be like to slowly suffocate while being trapped in this small space. And, you know, at the same time, there were a lot of people on the internets that were finding joy and schadenfreude and excitement from the death of these, you know, millionaires and billionaires. And I think that that was really disgusting to me. I mean, I don't care. Yes, we have too many billionaires and, you know, not at paying $250,000 a pop for a ticket under the sea, or $1 million for a ticket to space. You know, that doesn't mean that we can't find someplace in ourselves to feel a little bit of heartbreak for human beings who clearly, we thought were suffering. Probably, mercifully, they would have died
in an eye blink.
So, however, you know, anybody who said that in many of these communities was ganged up on. You know, it was like, well, what about the 750 migrants who died, who drowned horribly, you know, that were ignored by the Greek Coast Guard? And it's not an either or. Of course, that's a barbaric tragedy, and people should be punished for that, and we should be ashamed as a species for that, and for the fact that they even needed to be on that boat in the first place under those circumstances. But that doesn't mean we can't have a simple human response to the idea of people, no matter how rich or poor, you know, slowly expiring under the sea.
Right.
I mean, it is kind of an either or, though, like in the media locus and the general public's attention and what we give care and consideration to, it absolutely is an either or. I think that's why people didn't really feel sympathy, other than like the fact that like the story was so intriguing in itself. Like, we don't, there's not like deep dives on the people we lost who were the migrants on that boat. Like, there's not like Guardian articles talking about what they had for lunch the week before. Like, I'm not saying for us as the observer, there's an either or, but for media conglomerates and where our attention goes, yeah, there's definitely an either or.
So, Carolyn, I think the other part of this is that we live in a world now where, because of the way the digital space is constructed, you can try to know everything, or you can try to know the everything that's important to you. And it shows up now. I mean, to me, I associate this an awful lot with our obsession with true crime through true crime podcasts and Netflix documentaries and things like that. And there can often be two or three different documentaries about one murder case at this point. And there is that idea, right? You were sort of describing the experience that if you wanted to know something a little bit more, there's that sense also of, well, if I just got the complete picture, and one of the deceptions of getting the complete picture is the more details you know, the more almost anything seems possible. For example, Mr. Rush was asked apparently by somebody, I think some people who were doing a documentary or some kind of filming down in the submersible, what would happen if it ran out of oxygen? And he just said, well, you'd die anyway. Which seems like a strange thing for a guy in his business to say. But, you can know enough so that you can feel as though this was foretold in some way, or it's in a Simpsons episode, or, you know, when you start to collect a lot of information, you get information about everything.
Yeah, I think that you're 100% right that we feel that we can get, that we're like that citizen sleuth trend that we see where people, you know, using the internet think that they're going to solve these crimes. I think that, you know, for most of us, it's like, what is the most exciting thing in our day typically on a general day? Like having something like this where you can go on this like deep dive of learning about a submersible or how, you know, what that disaster would be, or what they see when they would look out a window and seeing the wreck of the Titanic, or understanding all these like weird little multi-layers of clairvoyance from like a Simpsons episode that seemed to cite this, to the fact that there was a book with a ship called the Titan that sunk and that came out before the Titanic ever even happened. You know, I think it's just kind of this fun little scavenger hunt that can like occupy, I find it to be a more healthy way of like scrolling through the internet or scrolling through social media than, you know, just looking at outfits or cat videos. At least you're learning something. I learned a lot about deep sea diving through this and discovering things. So I think there's an unhealthy level of getting involved in something or judging something. And like what David was saying, where you're really just like throwing stones at these millionaires for how they choose to spend their money. And then that being their demise.
All right. We have to take a little break here. When we come back, we will make some recommendations. We will be back after this.
When you pass the Sula, the submarine line, far in the deep sonar eyes, never sleep, hiding like a shadow in the night. Jet planes nose through the clouds above.
I'm sorry if I sounded a little abrupt at the end there. My headphones, which apparently are broken, were beginning to cut out, and it was a very odd experience. So anyway, I've got new headphones now. I'm back. We're back. David Edelstein, America's greatest living film critic, Sam Hadleman, who works in music public relations, hosts the Sam Hadleman Show at Radio Free Brooklyn. Carolyn Payne, actress, comedian, dancer, founder and director and choreographer of Kinetic Dance, and a director and everything else. They're all with us. Our technical producer today is Kat Pastor, and our producer of this episode, as is almost always the case with The Nose, is Jonathan McPants. I want to remind you also, The Nose Letter is coming out, one of our fortnightly editions. This is coming out tomorrow. If you want to get signed up, you can go. Where can they go? To WNPR, no, ctpublic.org/Colin. I think you'll find a little sign up thing there. All right, it's time to make some recommendations. Who should go first? Sam Hadelman, why don't you get us going?
All right, I got two recommendations today. First is Apple TV's new show, Platonic, with Seth Rogen and Rose Byrne. She's Australian, I don't know. It's really good. I think it's been interesting to watch like people who we really resonated with like in their 30s, you know, 10 years ago with Knocked Up and Seth Rogen's Run, kind of evolve in front of our eyes and have to tackle some of the issues that come along with being 40, even 50, and midlife crises and dyeing your hair. It's a really interesting show. Like most of the time, you don't really see a show about like, it's basically about a dude and a woman who are just trying to be friends at a pivotal moment of their lives. It's really funny. It's cheeky. Seth Rogen's great on TV. I don't think he's been on TV since like Freaks and Geeks or something. It's really good. It's really strong. The other one I'm going to recommend is an album called Ganger by V's. Full disclosure, and I let Jonathan know beforehand, I worked on this album on the PR side, but I'd be recommending it either way. It's a gorgeous album. I think the New York Times called him a folk hero of sorts. It's fun. It's zany. It's one of the best albums I've heard in a very, very long time. The Washington Post called it the best rap album of the year. If you're bored this weekend and want to hear what your kids are listening to, listen to Ganger by Bees.
All right. I actually spent my entire weekend, I'm spending my entire weekend listening to FBG Duck, so I don't go in for that fancy rap stuff. All right. I actually did spend, I think, Wednesday night watching FBG Duck videos with my son because he wanted to, and they are really, really horrible and alarming. Don't watch them. Of course, Carolyn Payne, earlier today I told you not to do something, and you did it anyway. So what are you going to be recommending?
Well, I'm definitely not going to be recommending what you told me not to do that
we
I did.
We can tell this story, which is that I was sort of looking for some kind of essay that analyzed the way in which the experience of the Titan got turned into this kind of enthralling and maybe stimulating form of discourse, and people were just constantly, you know, carving it up in different ways for their own pleasure. And I made the mistake of Googling submersible porn. Do not Google submersible porn. And that's what I told the panel, and somebody had to go do it. All right. You know, you'll never unsee those sites.
I did it. It's horrible. I'll never unsee any of that. So thank you. Well, that continues to haunt my brain. I will recommend this past weekend, I was spending time with my 8-year-old nephew. He's at that age where he doesn't watch kid things anymore, but my brother and sister-in-law are kind of strict about what he does get to watch. So finding cool things is always our goal. And we discovered on Netflix, it came out a while ago, but it's definitely worth the watch. It's called Death by Magic. And it is a fascinating, it's fascinating. It's this magician Drummond Money Coutts who travels around and redoes tricks that famously killed magicians. And he learns about the history of the trick and redoes them in sometimes the exact same way. Sometimes he adds a twist. It's just a fun summer watch and quite enjoyable.
How old is your nephew?
Eight.
Eight. Oh yeah. No. Hey mom, we watched Death by Magic. The tricks that killed real life magicians. It was fun. Well, David and I could probably come up with a list of things that you can watch with an 8-year-old because we've both been through that. But anyway, continue.
Yes. And the other thing that I am going to endorse is I have decided that this is really Barbie summer. The summer 2023 is really Barbie summer. And the soundtrack for the movie that is coming out has been mostly released. And if you were a teenager in the 90s, a young teen like me, and the song Barbie Girl by Aqua came out, and that dictated an entire summer of my life back as a, you know, child, teen. And now we are getting a remix of that with Ice Spice, and it is just wonderful.
And Nicki Minaj.
Nicki Minaj, I believe.
Yes, you are correct.
And it is just so delightful. I love it. And it has been playing on loop for me in part of my cycle of music. So,
well, on our Song of the Summer show, I incorrectly predicted that Dua Lipa's song from the Barbie movie was going to be the Song of the Summer, which it pretty clearly is not. All right, David Edelstein, you have the floor.
Well, speaking of the Titanic, one of the great metaphors that that has came out of that horrible tragedy is the orchestra playing as the ship went down. And I think if I'm asked to recommend something in pop culture, it's a little hard because you know, this past week the planet has been hotter than any time since the dinosaurs. So I think of all of this as the orchestra playing on the Titanic. That being said, if you want to, if you do want some entertainment, well, don't seek out entertainment. Jeffrey Toobin has a new book. I always mention him because I don't think he's going to get much airtime on NPR. About the rise of white-wing extremism called Homegrown. It's another look at Timothy McVeigh, but how profoundly relevant what happened, you know, those decades ago looks now. Also, along the same lines, I saw yesterday on Broadway a very funny one-man show, Just for Us, by a solo performer named Alex Edelman. He is a Jewish boy who found himself at a white supremacy meeting. It's extremely funny. It's extremely scary. You know, if you can make light of such a thing, he does it very successfully. Let me also mention about Barbie. M.G. Lord has a wonderful book about the history of Barbie that I believe is out of print. However, it is still available for downloading. I don't remember the name of it right now, but M.G. Lord is the writer. She's very good, and it's a really good book.
All right. So I'm going to recommend, first of all, since we talked about Wes Anderson, I would recommend if you haven't tried things out, you should try out a few of his movies and some of the early ones. I think Rushmore is probably the most accessible of the Wes Anderson movies. The first one, Bottle Rocket, is also in a very indie way, you know, very indie, not very much money way, very accessible. Grand Budapest Hotel is a marvel. And my own sort of secret, well, it's not a secret at all. I've watched The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou probably four or five times at this point, and it does sort of unfold little new mysteries to me all the time, and I get more information out of it. And it does end with a submersible scene with a whole bunch of people from the cast packed into a tiny submersible. So that's another possible way to go. The other thing that I'll endorse, this is like if it's really hot out and you don't want to leave the house and you want to just binge and stuff like that. My partner and I have been binging Justified, the Timothy Oliphant series, which we actually saw the first time around. So we're kind of re-binging it. Oliphant is just perfect as this Elmore Leonard character, this guy who, you know, is pretty quick on the draw as a U.S. Marshal. I mean, modern day U.S. Marshal in Harlan County, Kentucky. And there's just this incredible parade of character actors, the kind of Michael Rapaport, McKelty Williamson type. And of course, Walton Goggins is there all the way through it, and he is completely amazing as Boyd Crowder. Just wonderful. Oh, and Margot Martindale, obviously, as Mags, maybe one of the great evil roles that she's ever been allowed to play. So it's a lot of fun. I mean, it doesn't really mean anything, and people get shot rather casually. So if that kind of thing bothers you, if gunshots bother you, you should probably not watch Justified. But it's a lot of fun, and there's a new iteration of it coming out, which I hope we will discuss on the nose when it comes. I think this one's set in Detroit and based on a different Elmore Leonard novel. Anyway, thanks so much for listening today. Thanks to our wonderful panel, including America's Greatest Living Film Critic, David Edelstein, Carolyn Payne, Sam Hadleman. We'll be back next week with more.
Very, very cool place to hang out. Yeah. It's cozy, like a Cracker Barrel. Yeah, we all be laughing, talking, joking. Talking about this and talking about that, and talk about everything as a matter of fact. Oh yeah, talk about Torrington, Vernon, Danbury, Waterbury, Oliveberry, Woodbury, hitting on New Britain, Vernon. I already said that one. Avon, Farmington. Yeah, 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 yeah.
On the radio.